at that time, I changed that and set her for today, when I knew that the children would be singing and participating in the manner in which they are, and knowing as well that you would receive her as in a moment she shall come before us. As we are in this season of Thanksgiving, the children's songs, of course, being that today, encouraging our hearts, reminding us to be thankful for all of the blessings that God has given unto us. If you will turn to the book of Acts, the Acts of the Apostles, and I'm going to read the passage that Sister Lania will be focusing on when she indeed comes before us. The Acts of the Apostles, chapter 12. And again, as we are focusing on Thanksgiving, we want to remember the young people, the youth, and of what they have to offer, and of that being a blessing in our lives today. From Acts chapter 12, and I will read the first 17 verses, and then we will have our messenger to come. It reads as follows. Now about that time, Herod the king stretched out his hand to harass some from the church. Then he killed James, the brother of John, with a sword. And because he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to seize Peter also. Now it was during the days of unleavened bread. So when he had arrested him and put him in prison and delivered him to four squads of soldiers to keep him, intending to bring him before the people after Passover. Peter was therefore kept in prison, but constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. And when Herod was about to bring him out that night, Peter was sleeping, bound with two chains between two soldiers, and the guards before the door were keeping the prison. Now behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the prison. And he struck Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, "Arise quickly." And his chains fell off his hand. Then the angel said to him, "Gird yourself and tie on your sandals." And so he did. And he said to him, "Put on your garment and follow me." So he went out and followed him and did not know that what was done by the angel was real, but thought he was seeing a vision. When they were past the first and the second guard posts, they came to the iron gate that leads to the city, which opened to them of its own accord. And they went out and went down one street, and immediately the angel departed from him. And when Peter had come to himself, he said, "Now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me from the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the Jewish people." So when he had considered this, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a girl named Rhoda came to answer. When she recognized Peter's voice, because of her gladness, she did not open the gate, but ran in and announced that Peter stood before the gate. But they said to her, "You are beside yourself." Yet she kept insisting that it was so. So they said, "It is an angel." Now Peter continued knocking, and when they opened the door, and saw him, they were astonished. But motioning to them with his hand to keep silent, he declared to them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. And he said, "Go tell these things to James and to the brethren." And he departed and went to another place. As these words will in a moment be regarded among other thoughts from our young speaker, we have again certainly a young lady of the church, whom I asked to be our youth speaker sometime before the end of this year. It was several months ago that she wanted to speak with me, and it was in regards to some spiritual matter that she was dealing with. And I was so impressed with how she expressed herself and her understanding of the scriptures to that point. And as we talked about the issue that was at hand, I did ask of her and offered this invitation to be our youth speaker sometime before the year was out. And she graciously agreed to that. We have one who is a sophomore at Central High School. Sister Lania is a member of the Stingettes dance team. They get together when the athletic teams, such as the football games, are going on. The Stingettes do their part to encourage them and to get the crowd involved at the game. She's a member of the track team at Central. She's a member of the Future Business Leaders Club. She's also in the advanced program at the school. And I said to her, "I guess next week you're going to be the principal." She has involved herself in so many ways, and certainly we all recognize her as being involved in the church, participating in whatever way, in whatever manner that she is asked or that she volunteers to do. I am asking that at this time you give her your undivided attention, that you pray for her as she shall come forward. This is not something that the young people do every week. It is different. And so she needs your prayers and your attention and your support. It gives me pleasure to present to you at this time our own Lania Crossan. Let us receive her by saying amen.
First point is to explain the situation of Peter's arrest and his release and the meeting with the believers. Okay. Can y'all hear me? Okay. So my first point is to explain the situation of Peter's arrest and his release and meeting with the believers. Peter was arrested for preaching the name of Jesus, which it was against the law to preach the word to others because they didn't want others to be learning the name of Jesus. And what the believers was doing right was they was gathering together to receive and learn the word of God. And they was praying, and they thanked God they could gather together, worship, and pray. And what the believers was doing wrong was they failed to believe Rhoda, who told them Peter was at the door. Rhoda was a young member of the church, which she had been hearing Peter speak, so she was like a strong believer. And even when people didn't believe her, when she said Peter was at the door, she held on to what she knew, and she kept telling them, like, Peter was at the door. So, and then the believers also didn't thank God that he had created a place for teenagers and uses the teenagers in many ways throughout the church. So some issues that teenagers face today is they feel that they're not taken seriously. They feel like if they don't, like, I don't know how to explain it. They feel like if they're not in the crowd, then they're not going to fit in with everybody else. They feel like if they're not out smoking weed, if they're not at every party, if they're not there when a fight breaks out, then they're not going to be a normal, like a teenager, I guess. And they feel like they're not given a chance to get things right, meaning that they don't feel they have a second chance in life. They don't feel they have the time to get things right, to prove they can get their life together. And they're seeing bad examples, such as seeing teens drop out of high school, seeing people smoke, seeing teens smoke weed, teen pregnancies, and not having a clear understanding about God and church, because they probably never had that family who went to church or someone that told them that God is the head of their life. So they can also get the guidance that they need to get their life on track. What the Lord desires for our youth is that they know him so they can be strong leaders and believers of the Lord, and that they learn that the Lord will use them through singing, playing instruments, being a youthful leader, and just coming to church and getting his word. That they come to the church to learn more about the Lord, because I feel like in this generation now, it's important, because every other week, there's a teenager losing their life. So I feel like that it's important for everybody to go to church. That they participate in church, such as being in the choir, playing instruments, attending Sunday school, such as we have the Hands of Praise here, so just involving themselves any way they could by volunteering or anything. That they learn from others to pray and have faith and realize their self-worth with the Lord and themselves with being a strong leader for the Lord. Setting goals in life and strategies. Like, I have a goal to attend a HBCU, such as Alabama A&M or Alabama State University. And I want to major in business to become a business agent. But I know in order for me to do that, I have to start by getting good grades and making sure that I can do, if I could go and learn from somebody who's been in business as a long time, I can learn how to complete the goals that I want to do when I go to college and stuff. Also, being a member of Baptized Pentecostal means a lot to me, because it helped me grow closer with the Lord and helped me grow close to members I can talk to anytime and pray with. For example, Miss Pam, she talks to me, and Sister Hutchinson talks to me, and like I grew close with them. The effect it had on my life was I was a troubled teenager, and I fought my parents all the time because they went and let me do the stuff that I wanted to do, and I felt like they was always trying to just keep me in the house and just keep me from having fun with my friends. But I had to learn the hard way that they were trying to protect me from all the bad things that was going on. And I disobeyed the rules, like I would lie about where I was going. And my mom knows a lot of people, so she would find out anything about what I was doing. I tried to like get in where I didn't fit in, as my Uncle Skip would say. Like, I was like, my freshman year, I was hanging out with girls who all they did was beef with people. And I constantly got the reputation of she's a pop off, because people knew if they came and told me that somebody said something about me, I was gonna go to them and be like, okay, so what's up? Like, what you talking about me for? And I had to learn, like, the hard way that it's not the reputation you want, because people's not gonna like you, people's not gonna wanna be around you. And people knew that, like, I could be a likable person. But people know that you can't run over me, you can't push me, because like at some point I'm gonna let you know I'm not the one to play with. So don't like try me. The persons that have influenced my life is my mother, because she had me at 16 years old, and to see my mom just be successful in what she's doing, and she's taught me a lot about being strong and powerful and independent and making sure that I take her business, because she knows that I have goals that I want to accomplish, so she knows that if she pushes me harder, then I'm going to accomplish them. Also, my daddy, Stanley, over there, he influenced me, because even though he's not my biological father, he came into my life at the age of 2, and he took care of me. He gave me the fatherly love that I never had, and I love him so much. The advice I have for the youth is to be a leader in everything that you do. Thank you. Never let anyone tell you can't amount to anything, because you can, as long as you keep the faith. And I've seen people. When I went to Butler last year, it was the girls that was like, my mom tells me every day, I'm not going to be nothing. I'm not going to graduate. I'm stupid, I'm ugly, and I would always be like, it's not true. Like, as long as you do your work and you know that you're doing the right thing, then you could prove them wrong in the end. And I've seen people that I went to school with that now they're like, they're not successful. But all the time they talk about like how they're gonna turn it around, and I always try to say, go to church. Like, go find a church that you feel like is right for you. And they don't listen to me sometimes, but I'm just like, at least I tried, you know, at least I'm encouraging them. I encourage the youth to pursue their dreams and goals, even if it's short or long-term goals, because I try every day to, like, reach one of my goals. And one of my goals was accomplished. I got to go to the Magic City Classic, and I got to see both the schools that I wanted to go to. And I got to see how, I got to talk with the coaches and hear how they, when you try out for the dance team, what they're looking for, so I know what I need to work on. And I accomplished that goal, because I thought I was gonna have to wait forever to go and see them. Make sure you always pray, because I was bad at that. Like, I never really prayed, because I was like, I don't feel like I need to, because I feel like he knows what I'm going through. But once I started praying and stuff, it was like stuff started like becoming like more easy, and he started giving me signs of like, you don't need to be doing that. Like, if I felt like something was wrong, I just knew it was a sign from God. Read the Bible, because that would help too. Reading certain scriptures, it would be like, dang, I was going through this, like, this is really speaking to me. Stay out the streets, because I've had plenty of friends that's been in the streets, and nothing's going good for them right now. It's just like, they're lost, and I'm trying to help them find their way, but I can only do so much for a person who's probably not going to listen to me. Stay positive in anything, like, involve yourself in positive things, like going to Bible study, having talks with God. My mom was laughing what I was doing, but I was writing little notes and I was putting on my mirror, and it was basically like giving me encouragement to be better, be a better person, and talk to your pastor, because I talk to him about anything. Everybody might not see me talk to him, but I talk to him a lot. And I give myself a pep talk, like, every day before I go to school. I just stand in my mirror and I just be like, you got this. Like, if I got a test, especially in my AP classes, like, if I got a test, I just be like, you got this, you can do it. Just read your notes and you got it. But that's it, I guess. Yeah.
Well, certainly thanks, Sister Lania. You've got another 20 minutes about to go. But certainly, she said so much in a short span of time, didn't she, as she was explaining and talking about some of her own experiences and then looking at and explaining some of the scriptural elements of the young lady in that passage of scripture by the name of Rhoda. And you can read that again for yourselves. I appreciate you bringing out all of the points that you did and of the light that you have shining that others might see, and especially those of your generation of whom you come in contact with, and other elements of your message before us, encouraging to us all, Are there any questions that you would like to ask Sister Lania at this time? Anyone have any questions to ask? Yes, sir. Go ahead, Kevin.
Because I was like sick of being. Sometimes I would just be like, why am I even beefing with this person? Like, we was cool at first, and then I guess since I was closer with the group that was troublemakers, I would be like, okay, so then I cooed you. I was basically being a follower. But it took me to realize that I was sick of being in the principal's office. I was sick of being in the counselor's office, and they're just like, why are you in it? Do you not see, look at your grades, like, you need to be focused on better things than what they're doing, because they were like, you're smarter than, you're book smart, you're not street smart. So basically, you need to get out, the what they're doing. So.
Any other questions?
I plan on to go to college and major in business and to graduate. And I want to be a business agent because I want to travel a lot. And I just basically want to have my own money and stuff like that. So. Well, I've been knowing since like third grade what school I wanted to go to, because it was like when, what do you think? My third grade teacher, her husband, he had went to Alabama A&M. So she had a whole bunch of like Alabama A&M stuff in her room. And so one day I was like, what's their school? And she showed me like their band and their dancers. And I was like, well, I'm a dancer and I like what they're doing. So then that's when I started researching like more about the school. And I asked my granddaddy, I was like, what's some good HBCUs? And he was like, Alabama A&M, Alabama State. And he started naming a lot, and I just started researching them. And when I found, I've been knowing since third grade that I've been wanting to do business. So when I looked it up and they said they had good business programs and they had a good dance team, I was like, okay, so this is where I want to be. And my mother's in business, so she kind of had a little effect know how to make a change because I was sick and getting beat up every day by my mama. And because like my brothers, they basically look up to me because I'm the oldest. And when I seen like my brothers was doing the same thing I was doing, it was just like, I don't want them to, like, I don't want this to continue on. So I was like, I gotta fix myself so they could be like, okay, she's not doing no more, so I'm not gonna do no more. But I mean, I'm still a work in progress, but I mean, things are getting better. Well, I went to Butler last year, so I don't really talk to nobody that went to Butler no more because everybody's still there, it's still drama field. But when I came to Central, I'm not going to say that I'm, like, popular, but I already knew, like, everybody there. So I just walked in with a clear mind. I basically didn't want to judge anybody that wanted to be friends with me, and I learned that through people's actions, like, if I wanted to be around them and if I wanted to be friends with them, because it's some girls that was trying to be friends with me that would, like, teachers would be like, you don't even hang around them, they're drama field. And the type of person that I could see that you are just by looking at you, you're very focused on graduating and completing your goals, so I don't want them distracting you from what you're trying to do. So I just kind of leave them people alone and kind of do me.